thank you for these millennials that are setting the stage and give us hope for the future. And we give a shout offering of praise to you. Sings for us a powerful prayer and a declaration.
You want them to remain standing or you want to dance? Go ahead and have a seat. How do we pull this all together as we look to our Heavenly Father? Oh, beautiful, for spacious sky. For amber waves of grace, for purple mountain majesty, above the fruited plain, America, America, God shed His grace.
Now we're going to close the this with the prayer of God, the blessing that he gave, given by the priests of Israel, my fathers, that God himself wrote the words to, and said, when you give this, you will place my name upon them. So now join me as I give this, the Aaronic blessing, to America. Make it your prayer. Lift up your hands with me. You are the priests of God. You close your eyes.
Welcome. Amen. Amen.
national anthem.
Yes.
Besides Israel. On our first date, I said, I'm Jim, as we met. She says, no, your legal name would be James. That's the Greek version of the Hebrew word Jacob, and Jacob is translated Israel. I knew I had made a thing. Tommy Waller is coming. If you have, how many of you have been to Israel? Raise your hand. How many want to go back to Israel? When you go, if you have not gone to Samaria and seen what Hayavel is doing in the hills of Samaria, fulfilling Jeremiah 31, Jeremiah 31, verse 5, will you be talking about that specifically? Maybe you won't. Jeremiah 31, 5 says the no tree, the watchman will come. And basically, they will assist the Jewish farmers. That was prophesied for 2,700 years. A FedEx manager from Tennessee was called by God to move his 11 kids to an Amish community, learn the trade of farming. From there they moved to Israel, and they bring in now hundreds and hundreds of people from over 30 nations who come and volunteer and give their time free to plant, cultivate, and harvest the grapes on the hills of Samaria. And the word notzrim in the Hebrew is the modern word for Christian. The Christians are coming and doing what Jeremiah declared, and they would bless the Jewish people and bless Israel and bless the Jewish farmers. And the man who God planted it in is this unusual figure with an incredible, incredible anointing upon his life. Tommy Wollin. Would you welcome Tommy Wollin?
I am, as Jim said, an unusual figure. How I got here is amazing. It's been an amazing journey. I'm very thankful. Michelle Bachman is such an inspiration to me. She's been with me on the mountains in Rosemary as well. And I know several people here that have been in these places. And it's such a pivotal time because as I sit here with my Jewish friends, my Jewish brothers and sisters, it's an honor to be able to rectify the wound that has happened between us, believers, Christians, and Jews. Many of us don't really even know the stories. Unfortunately, our Jewish friends do know the stories. They do know the things that have happened over the thousands of years. And the one thing that I believe that we have is a place of humility. We come to the land of Israel and we're able to offer our hands in servitude. It changes the dynamics of our relationship. And I think it is the one thing that, especially as our organization works on the mountains of Israel, and as we work in this very place, the very target that the UN resolution was focusing on, East Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, And I would just challenge you to learn, to understand. Unfortunately, most Christians, many Christians, don't even know where the target actually is. And I want to just share with you that this is a fight that we have to biblically engage in. It's a fight that we have to biblically engage. It's no longer okay to be indifferent. It's no longer okay to be just to live life as we've always lived in the status quo of the Israeli situation. We have to engage in this. And I'm challenging us. This is the 50th year of the liberation of Jerusalem in 1967. The 50th year. The 50th year. Does that ring a bell? This is the Jubilee. The Jubilee. The Yom Bell year is right now, right about to be celebrated in Jerusalem, and Christianity needs to celebrate with it. We need to celebrate with Jerusalem. We need to recognize that in 6 days, God set a miracle. He did a miracle in 6 days. How many of us agree with that? We have to agree with it. If you're a believer here, it's not an option whether you want to walk with it or stand with it. It's not an option anymore. I want to close with this last quote. This is by Elie Wiesel. He said, "The opposite of love is not hate, it's indifference." Yeah. The opposite of beauty is not ugliness, it's indifference. The opposite of faith is not heresy, it's indifference. The opposite of life is not death, but indifference between life and death. It's time for us to stop being indifferent. Let's put feet on our servitude. Our Messiah, Yeshua, the one we believe, the anchor of our faith, said that I came not to be served, but to serve. And how many of us are going to put feet on, show a difference, to make a difference in our relationship with the Jewish people? I challenge you that this is the year we can begin to do that.
Yeah.
Amen.
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 On trips to Israel now, there is a special new highlight that many trips are now ending with. It is so, so powerful on the human emotions when you walk through what's called Friends of Zion Heritage Center. It's much more than a museum. It's interactive. It's sensory. You touch walls and figures come on and talk to you. You put out your hand and reflections come and show you the names of people who died in the Holocaust. You move through the museum and it involves all the senses. And people now, as they go to Israel, make this the final event of their trip. The man behind this is Mike Evans, who stood with Israel for so many decades. I think the building he's built is something over $25 million, and they're expanding it by another $50 million or more. It has become one of the epicenters in helping the Jewish people understand how strongly we as evangelical Christians, how passionate we are about helping them defend their land and support them as the Jewish people. Would you welcome Mike Evans?
But in 1852, this synagogue did not have the rights that Christian churches had. They didn't. So the Congress in 1854 passed a resolution that all Hebrew congregations should have the same rights that Christian congregations have. We say that to the nation of Israel. Your home is our homes. Nobody's going to tell us we can't build a house. Nobody's going to tell you you can't build yours either. I've been defending Israel for 40 years. It's been my honor. Zionism is the greatest. It's the greatest people movement in history. Inspiring, activating, uniting the defense of a people in history. But the second greatest one is called Christian Zionist. That's who you are today, Christian Zionist. And by the way, my rabbi friend, it might sound like heresy, but the vast majority of Zionists in the world are not Jewish. They're Christian Zionists. There's hundreds of millions of them. The Prime Minister of Israel said this: I don't believe the Jewish state and modern Zionism would have been possible without Christian Zionism. I was in Jerusalem when Donald Trump heard the words, and I was with the chief rabbi of Moscow, and he looked at me and he said, it's a miracle of God. He didn't know I was on the board, but he said, it's a miracle of God. Do you know what God did today? I said, Rabbi, tell me what he didn't do. He said, this week, every Jew in the world reads in the scriptures the story of the blessing of Abraham. It's our Torah reading this week. And he said, this man chose to bless Israel and also to stand with the sixth commandment, thou shalt not kill. And God gave him the presidency. Say amen to that. I believe it with all my heart. There's so many heroes. You don't know, and you can go to Friends of Zion and hear about him. Like the founder of the Red Cross, the first Christian Zionist, John Henry Dunant, who's the first Nobel Peace Prize winner. Or John Patterson, who led the first Jewish fighting force in 2,000 years, Christian Zionist. Or maybe George Bush, but he was 1844. Professor of Hebrew, relative of our two presidents, who wrote a book on the restoration of Israel. It sold 1 million copies. It was read by Theodore Herzl. Or Wingate, who founded what is now considered the IDF, the Night Squads, Christian Zionist. We're fighting a battle right now together with you, Israel. It's a big battle. It's an ideological war. It's a media war. It's an economic war. And that war cannot be won alone. We can win it together, and we will win it together. Friends of Zion is more than a museum. It's a massive social network movement. We are growing by more than 2 million members a month, and that's conservative. We now have over 2 million members alone in a Muslim country, Indonesia. And we're building friends all over the globe. All over the globe, friends for the nation of Israel. Because today we have a problem. The depth of the book must compete with the speed of the screen, a screen that hypnotizes and distorts. So he who defines the terms controls the debate. Yeah. And we have determined, for you Israel, hope is on the way. Yeah. And we are one in prayer, about Jerusalem. You know what? One of the last things President Obama did? He waived the Jerusalem Embassy Act. He just signed the 6-month waiver. But I'm kind of glad he did. You know why? Because the waiver comes up the week of the 67 war. When Israel was restored in fulfillment to prophecy, our bodies are in Washington, D.C., but Jerusalem, our souls are in Jerusalem, D.C., yeah. David's capital.
Yeah.
Once again, Congressman Trent Franks, who is the co-chair of the Israel Allies Caucus. Congressman.
You know, I think it's so appropriate to get to tell you something I'm going to tell you in a few moments. But first of all, I'd just like to start out and tell you that as the chairman of the Israel Allies Caucus, so many people come up to me and they say, why are you Christians? Why are you so focused on Israel? Why does it mean so much to you? And of course, those of you in the audience, you know that Christians cannot explain our existence without Israel. Yeah. It is the place where our Savior came and walked this earth. It means everything to us. And so oftentimes I have some of my Jewish friends, they say, well, the only thing, you know, maybe you just care as evangelical Christians, you just want to evangelize Israel. And I said, oh, it's worse than that. We want to evangelize the whole world. But there is a love in our hearts, there is a love in our hearts to the state of Israel that is absolutely transcendent to many of us. All of you know that. You know that there's something in our souls that says, if we do right by Israel, God will do right by us. And we really believe that admonition when the Lord said to Jacob, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, thou shalt be called Israel. And I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And then remember, he said, and in thee shall all of the nations of the earth be blessed. I want you to know one of the reasons I care so much about Israel is because I believe every time America blesses Israel, we give the children that we love so much a chance to walk in the light of freedom in the future in this country. We do more for our own country by blessing Israel sometimes than we do Israel. And so oftentimes people say, well, Israel, you know, we do so much for them. But I am of the opinion that America is the recipient of more blessing from Israel than they are of us. I am convinced that America never would have come to be if it weren't for Israel. I am convinced that one little short Jewish gentleman by the name of Albert Einstein knew that he could come here and find safety, and because of that, we beat the Nazis to the nuclear war. I am someone that believes desperately that the only hope for America, that our ultimate hope, is if we somehow understand that God has called Israel like he's called no other nation on earth, and that our job and our calling before God is to make sure that we do not turn our back on Israel. Now, let me be very, very careful. I feel like the political leadership of America in recent days betrayed Israel.
Yes, right.
And that frightens me, ladies and gentlemen. But I'm also convinced that God has a plan.
Come on.
And that this here, in this church, that once was a Jewish synagogue, and that now holds people that love Israel like no other people on earth love Israel, I have the wonderful privilege, some of you may know, that I've introduced legislation that has been introduced into Congress the first week of the session that will bring back from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem the capital of Israel. I'm here to say to you that I believe that America will be a better, more prosperous, more blessed nation if we honor Israel and recognize Jerusalem as the eternal capital of the state of Israel and as appointed by God from the very beginning of time. Yeah.
The Jewish people, I believe, are the noblest people in all of human existence. If you consider all the things that they have come through, all the ways they have been broken, all the ways they've been hurt, and yet, if you go down into the diggings of Israel today and go back into the time of David, and you find relics, if someone could walk up out of that time today, they would be able to communicate with the college student of 2016. That has been a noble, committed, relentless people of God. They have survived all the tragedies in the world. They survived the Holocaust. They've survived everything. And what people would have stayed and been as relentless as they have? Even what happened in Nazi Germany, how it crushed the people of Israel. Many people would have said, I give up. I give up. But they didn't. Even after that heartache, they dried their eyes, and they looked up, and they began to build again. And today, the Nazis are gone, and Israel remains.
Yeah.
And I believe that Israel's greatest days are ahead of her. And God, please let America be there beside her for our sake and for the sake of the whole world.
Yes.
May it happen. God help us. And may the light of God's peace shine down upon the streets of Jerusalem forever.
Amen. I am so excited to introduce the next two speakers to you, our final speakers really for this event. Two things to care about very quickly. There's a card you find in your program. If you're wanting information about any of the individuals that have shared, if you'll just fill out that card and check the appropriate line that you'd like to be connected or know more information from that particular individual or their ministry or what they've done, fill out that card if you would, and then pass it down to the end of your pew and just leave it there at the end of your pew. Take care of that if you would. And then take a look at your program, if you would. The two members of the Knesset I'm just about to introduce to you right now. The first one is Sharin Haskell. Sharin is the youngest member of the Likud Party, the youngest member of the coalition. She was a member of the Israeli Defense Forces, a commander. She's known as the Israeli Margaret Thatcher. Would you welcome, member of the Knesset, Sharin Haskell. Welcome.
And it says that God told Abraham
to leave his property, his family, his friend, the land that he knows, the country that he knows, and go to a place that God will show him. And in this place, he will enlarge his name, and he will create a big nation, and he will bless them with milk and honey, with prosperity. And for many of us in Israel, the Jews, that history repeated itself about 68 years ago, a little bit longer, where because of persecution from different countries, from different governments, we had, my families, my grandparents, my parents, they had to leave their countries, their home, their families, their friends, many times their property, and go away to where? To a country that God had shown to Abraham as well. I can tell you that there was no milk and honey in this country when they arrived there. But with the blessing of us returning to our homeland, it grew. And today Israel is this strong nation full of milk and honey, technology, a strong economy, an army to defend itself. So history did repeat itself. And when Israel was founded, we had many existential threats, many of them. This attempt of annihilating our country, expelling the people from the country, a huge war. Think about it in terms of today. If America would go to war against Jordan and Lebanon and Iraq and Egypt and Arabia Saudi all together, what would you call that? It's a miracle.
That's right.
And it's a miracle, but we have a strong ally that stood beside us. It is this nation, this country, time after time stood beside Israel through these existential threats. And we overcame them together because we have a strong bond, not just a bond where the tradition and the culture and the religion are so important, like in Israel. Our history and heritage and religion are intertwined, are founded. This is the foundation of our country. But also those values of democracy, of freedom, of liberties, of equality, those values, they stick us together because we all believe in them. And today, Israel is repeating itself again. The history is repeating itself again. As we heard from Mike Evans about this war, this existential war that we're fighting on our economy and with the media, these lies are being spread about Israel and what it really is. But there's another existential threat that we are fighting. And it is about this attempt of disconnecting the relationship and the strong connection between the Jewish people and the land of Israel. Why is it an existential threat as well? Because what does it mean that the Jewish people sits in Israel if there isn't this strong connection of thousands of years? How easy it will be to expel the people from a country that they don't belong to. This is an existential threat as before, and it is fought in the international community, in the media. The UNESCO declaration that came out, what does it really mean? This is the organization that's in charge of preserving the history and heritage, is rewriting our history, the Jewish people's history, saying that Jerusalem have no relation or connection to the Jewish people, a city that is the center of our religion, our culture, and our identity for thousands of years. We've been praying for thousands of years. We pray for three times a day in our wedding, at every occasion or holiday. And they're saying that we don't have this connection.
Come on, man.
This is how they're fighting this war. And not just through the media as well in this resolution, but also what happened with the United Nations Security Council. That was another step towards it as well, to admit the connection between Judea and Samaria and Jerusalem, saying that Israel, that the Jewish people who are sitting there, that's an obstacle for peace and coexistence, that they don't belong there. If you walk through these lands, you see Shiloh, you see the cave of the forefathers. This relationship is impossible to disconnect. It is written in every book, in every verse of the Bible. And I pray that with this new administration that is coming in forward, with declarations that have been made already, saying that the embassy will move to Jerusalem, what does that really mean? This is reconnecting again. This is declaring that Jerusalem was always the capital of Israel. And not just because it is the democratic capital that we decided that this is going to be the capital of Israel, because it is the center of our religion. This is the center of our culture. It's been like that for thousands of years, and it will continue to be like that for thousands of years again. These organizations that are combating the connection to our history, to the land of Israel, those organizations, they are fighting Israel with a war, and it is giving aspiration to people, particularly, yes, to the Palestinians. It gives an aspiration when the world questions whether Jerusalem is the capital. Maybe one day the Jews will leave this city, will go away, will give it to the Palestinians. What does that mean? It means that the more resolution that comes through these international organizations, the more backing they have for more violence, right, hatred, right, and for that hope that at one day the Jews will leave Jerusalem and will go away. The fact that President-elect Trump, that's going to be inaugurated tomorrow, that would be a proof for those people that those hopes will be gone. That the strongest nation in the world, the home of the brave and the free, and the nation that protect the free world, will say it out loud. They will say that Jerusalem will forever stay the capital of Israel.
Prominent Orthodox rabbi
would be across the street that night giving a lecture. And the lecture would be on why not only Muslims should be allowed to pray on the Temple Mount, but the Jews, since that is their most sacred site, and Christians, and for that matter, all others, ought to be able to pray on the Temple Mount. Because of that, a young Muslim Arab rode up on a scooter directly across the street from Mount Zion Hotel and shot him in the chest point blank 4 times. It was questioned whether or not he could possibly survive, possibly live through that. Of the 10 assassination attempts in Israeli history, he is the first one to survive. And we happen to be back in June of 2016, and there in the Knesset, when he was being made a member of the Knesset, and with him that day. I cannot tell you what a hero this man is to all of us who know him. I was introduced to him through Grayson D.J. Wong. Great, Grayson, you'll step up to the platform right now. She lived 6 months in San Diego. She and her husband, part of our church in San Diego, 6 months of the year praying for the peace of Jerusalem in Israel. And she has formed a close relationship. They have formed a close relationship with Yehuda Glick. And so I'm going to have her pray for us. She's going to pray probably in Mandarin Chinese, I think, in her own language. She's going to pray for Yehuda Glick, and then he will come to speak to us this day.
Should we all stand up and straighten your head? Together we all will bless Rebecca Yehuda and Israel together. Hallelujah, 主耶稣，我们赞美你，众山怎样围绕耶路撒冷，耶和华也照样围绕他的百姓，从今时直到永远。 主耶稣，我们赞美你，谢谢你保护 Rebecca Yehuda 跟以色列的全家，如同保护你眼中的同人。主将他们藏在你翅膀的荫下。 愿耶和华祝福你，保护你；愿耶和华用他的脸光照你，施恩给你；愿耶和华向你扬眼，赐你平安。 Shalom to Jerusalem, Shalom to Rabbi Yehuda 跟以色列的全家。 In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen.
Materializing and becoming a reality. We are living in an era of miracles. No place in the world ever in the history of mankind has a nation uprooted from its homeland and returned to its homeland. Not after 50 years, definitely not after 2,000 years. And guys, is there anything greater than that? The people coming back to their homeland after 2,000 years, reviving the language, the venues, the culture? Yes, there is something greater. The fact that was going to happen appears in the book 3,000 years ago and said it's going to happen. Guys, we saw miracles after miracles 19 years after the establishment of the State of Israel. 200 million Arabs surrounding 2 million Jews in Israel had one goal, to erase the State of Israel. And in the history of world wars, we have a 100-year war, we have wars of months. Have you ever heard of a six-day war in where 2 million Jew people managed to overcome the biggest armies, the biggest air forces, and come back and return to the land of their forefathers and call in the name of Jerusalem? These are miracles. Ladies and gentlemen, every one of you who has a dollar bill in your pocket, that's a miracle. What does it say in the dollar bill? In God we trust. In the time of the Bible, you couldn't say that. They would say, which God? How many gods? How many multiple gods? In God. The very fact that it says in God, knowing there's one God, is a victory of God's Bible. When Isaiah said that there will come a day and all the nations will recognize the one and only God. In his time, there was only one Jewish people, way before Jesus, way before Muhammad. And here we see the biggest nation in the world saying, in God we trust, there's only one God. Miracles! Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, the fact, if I would tell you 100 years ago that there would be Christians supporting Israel, impossible! Miracles! Ladies and gentlemen, personally, as was mentioned before, 2 years ago, I was approached by a person who stood 1 foot away from me, 4 bullets to the center of my body. I was critically injured. There was no chance. As was said before, you go with the Wikipedia, of all these assassination attempt survivors, I'm the only one in Israel. And I was shot for one reason, because I symbolized Jerusalem as being the capital of God in the world, and there are those in the world who maybe the past administration were afraid to say the word. Those who are radical Islam, those who are using political Islam and believing that God is exclusive, only theirs. And we know that God is inclusive.
Right.
And God saved me. And that was my personal miracle. In my eyes, it meant God was telling me, Yehuda, your mission is not over. Yeah. Yeah. 7 months ago, against all the chances, I promised my wife there was no chance that I would ever make it into politics. I was number 33 on the Likud list. All the polls showed that we'd be between 19 and 21. And I told my wife, don't worry, I will not be a member of Knesset. Don't believe polls and don't believe husbands. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm in the Knesset. I'm not there to promote my personal career. I'm there to promote Jerusalem, the city of God, Jerusalem, the city of Shalom. Ladies and gentlemen, tomorrow, 21 hours from now, and 14 minutes, there will be another miracle! Believe that Donald Trump would be the next president of the United States of America. And what Sharon mentioned before, two flags parallel right next to each other. One tiny little country and one very big country. Can you believe it? Of all the nations, Donald Trump, throughout his campaign, again and again and again, repeatedly spoke about Israel and Jerusalem. a year, thousands of years. For 3,000 years, every Jewish couple getting married breaks a laugh and says, if I forget you, O Jerusalem, I'll forget my right hand. Every year in Passover, we celebrate and we praise next year in Jerusalem. Every time an observant Jew eats a piece of cake, he thanks God for the cake, thanks God for the land, and thanks God, don't forget, build Jerusalem. So we don't need the nations to recognize Jerusalem. The nations need it for themselves to recognize Jerusalem. Now, but one thing I wanted to point out. Yes, we are seeing miracles greater than any miracle in the Bible. The greatest miracle in the book we're beginning to read in this week's portion is the Exodus from Egypt. By the way, the book chapter that we're reading this week is about a new king who his daughter raised a Jewish child. And I want you to understand, Exodus from Egypt is the greatest miracle in the Bible. The return of the Jewish people from exile is 10 times greater. We were in Egypt for 250 years, we were in exile for 2,000 years. Egypt is one country, we were in 200 different countries. Egypt is 1,000 miles away from Jerusalem. Ethiopia is 20,000 miles away. So we are living in an era. But the specialty about the miracles in our generation, and this is the point I want you to listen to. Miracles in our generation are not those coming down from heaven where sea divides into suddenly miraculously. The miracles in our generation, the establishment of the state of Israel, so-called, happened rationally. People got up and established it. Those are the miracles. The miracles that are being taken out by people. The fact that Christians are recognizing Israel is because of you, each and every one of you. We don't have to wait for leadership. Tomorrow, Mr. Trump becoming the new president, and Mr. Pence the new vice president, who are so close friends of Jerusalem and Israel, they have the hands to choose. And as I mentioned before, 50 years after the reunification of Jerusalem, he can choose to be a Cyrus. He can choose to say Jerusalem, all the nations should recognize Jerusalem. And if he doesn't, there will be people who will get up and say, don't do it. But guys, number one, if I would have a dollar bill for every single time, they were warning us that if we do that, it'll be a third world war, I'd be a millionaire. How many were they begging David Ben-Gurion not to establish the state of Israel? They were begging Israel not to fight the Six-Day War. They're going to be begging Trump not to announce Jerusalem. But if he does, he will be the modern Cyrus written in the New Days era of the Bible. So therefore, we are here to pray, God. Give him the strength to do the right things.
Yes.
Give him the strength to choose the right choices that he knows are right.
Yes.
I'm here also to express thanks. Thank you, people. Thank you, first of all, personally. So many people bump into me and tell me we were praying on your behalf. Millions of people around the world have never met me. So here, first of all, I'm here alive today thanks to those prayers. I know the strength of prayers. Thank you. I'm here today, ladies and gentlemen, to speak in the name of Israel. It's not so thing we take for granted that we have so many genuine friends around the world. We're here to express how important, how meaningful it is for us, your friendship. We're at once so gracious, we're so thankful. Thank you very much for being our genuine allies in the world. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as I mentioned, just like the establishment of the State of Israel, couldn't be led by leadership without people there. And just like every one of the miracles we saw before could not have happened without those leading it, because we go, God will help us. Announcing and recognizing Jerusalem as the capital of the people of Israel, as the capital of God in the world, as the capital of Shalom, can only be reached, if not only by the leadership, it will be leading that has to be reached by the peoples of the world. And therefore, the Knesset has established a new initiative. And I'm going to read a few words and then I'll be concluding with that. It's called the Jerusalem Covenant. And I'm reading a few sentences of it. Jerusalem, peace and tranquility shall reign in the city. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be tranquil. May there be peace within your walls, tranquility within your palaces. Out of Jerusalem, a message of peace went forth and shall go yet go forth again into all inhabitants of the earth. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up a sword against nation, nor shall they learn war anymore. Our sages, peace be upon them, said, in the future, the Holy One, the Blessed One, will comfort Jerusalem only with peace. This is a Jerusalem covenant which we are hoping this year, in honor of the 50th reunification of Jerusalem, to have millions of people around the world sign it. And then you can do it, it takes 10 seconds, you can take out your smartphone even right now, go into JerusalemofPeace.com, and you can sign it, because we have millions of people who are going to be signing it this year, and then the leaders of the world will have to join it, will join it. And my final sentence is, I want to tell you, I was so excited sitting here today. And I was thinking about Cyrus, and when Lance mentioned that Isaiah 45, I was stunned. I was stunned. And I therefore want to thank you, Mr. Jim Garlow and Rosemary Schindler Garlow, for this wonderful, wonderful lecture. I want to thank you, Trent Franks, for continuing again and again leading the Congressional Israel Allies Caucus. Tommy and Waller, you didn't have to go to the hospital and be in the hospital at the same time I was, just to show me how much you love me. You brought me here, you invited me here. This is definitely a historical moment, and it's a privilege. I'm so thankful to you for bringing me here. I'm so thankful for God for allowing me to be here, and together with my dear friend Sharon Haskell, and together with the United States and all the people of America, and all the nations of the world, we are praying for the success of President Donald Trump and Vice President Biden.
Christian and Jew coming together, one of the largest Jewish organizations in America, is growing rapidly. You stand with us and led by Jewish people, except one particular chapter, a Christian is leading a Jewish organization. Sarah Miller, she happens to be part of our church family as well. Sarah, pray for Israel, pray for the Jewish people, and then we have a special announcement for you.
Let's pray for our Israel. Gracious and merciful Lord, we love you and we thank you for your goodness. You are the Lord who revives, protects, and invigorates. We ask for divine protection and favor over your Israel. May no enemy who comes against you prosper. May no evil scheme succeed. Cause her to shine in the darkest hours. You are faithful and you are good. Bless your ambassadors like Sharon and Yehuda. Raise up a fervent generation who will stand unabashedly for you and your eternal people. We pray for a renewed and unbreakable alliance between the United States of America and Israel. You are mighty and you are able to save for such a time as this. In your precious name, amen.
There's two special guests that we're just going to say a quick hi to you. And if we're going to do that, I said, if we have time. The fact is, we are so far off schedule. Those who have left are early Christians. Those who are still here are Latter-day Saints. I want you to welcome right now, ladies and gentlemen, George W. Bush. Will you welcome him?
To represent Christ, to have him living in your heart.
we are about to embark on a brand new era. Well, not era. Not era as in mistake, I mean era. No, era, not era like you fly into the air like with a bow, like the duck commanders might do. And I'm so excited about the new connection between my friend David Martin and President-elect Trump. And I'm sure that you guys have been talking about wall builders and building the wall. It's a beautiful thing. And you know, in the past, and some people have mistakenly talked about a two-state scenario. But ladies and gentlemen, I am here to state that Jesus Christ raised, God the Father raised in one place, Jerusalem, and in the hearts of men. God bless you, and God bless America.
Sing a song, you can sing with me. Oh Lord my God, when I am lost and wandering, consider all the worlds I hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the falling thunder.
United States of America. God bless you.